Hello friends, now in this second part of the extrusion technology lecture, we will study about the effect of various extrusion process parameters on the material characteristics as well as product characteristics, and also we will take up a few case studies where some of the products have been developed using extrusion technology, particularly in my laboratory. So, just to refresh your memories, we have seen in the part 1 of this topic, lecture part 1, that is extrusion is a thermomechanical process in which heat transfer, mass transfer, pressure changes and shear are combined to produce effects such as cooking, sterilization, drying, melting, texturization, puffing, mixing and kneading, forming, etc. So, basically so many things, this type of effects we can get right in the product by having a proper combinations of these characteristics of the material, characteristics of the extruder process variables and system variables, etcetera. Okay. So, again a specially designed die is used to shape the product such as the form of pasta, noodle, rice analogs, etcetera, or variety of products in the variety of shapes and sizes are produced using this technology. Regarding factor affecting the extrusion process, as I told you, that is the combination of the process parameters. By having appropriate combination of the process parameters, we can produce a product of desired characteristics in as well as we can get that desired system parameters to get the desired characteristics in the product. So, the important extrusion process parameters includes barrel temperature, die head temperature, extruder screw speed and feed moisture content. The product characteristics include physicochemical properties, functional properties, textural characteristics and cooking characteristics. These the process parameter etcetera, they influence the system parameters, that is the, and what are the extrusion system parameters? They are the torque, die pressure, product temperature, specific mechanical energy ends. Just in the earlier part of the lecture also we saw, here also you can say, that is in this picture you can see here, this is the feeding zone, this is the transition zone and this is the metering zone. The feeding zone is used for conveying the solid, in the transition zone compaction, mixing and softening of the material takes place, whereas in the metering zone there is a melting, pressurizing and pumping of the melt to the die. So, these processes, so obviously that is one. Then the die end, there is a cutter assembly which gives, okay, which cuts the product into the desired size and desired shape, desired size. Okay. So, this is these parameters, when you change different characteristics like extrusion, heating and melting, there is the heat is supplied by the heater, as you in which are provided the along with the barrel in the extruder. You can see that is a some extruder, they have 3 or 4 heating section like heater 1, heater 2 and heater 3, there are 3 heating zones here. Okay. So, these through this heater the heat is applied, also the heat is generated due to friction inside the screw barrel with inside the barrel. Okay. And then material is compacted as the screw channel depth reduces and the material flow is taking place in this direction in this case. Okay. So, the extruder screw actually mixes the material and converts it into a viscoelastic melt, particularly towards the end of the die. And then when it passes through the die, because of this flexible nature and because of this characteristics, it takes the shape of the die. And when it comes out of the die, inside the die, pressure and temperature are maintained. So, because of the pressure gradient, because of the temperature gradient, material either expands or compacts. So, this is the mechanism how these different products are characteristics form. So, how, let us see how this, if these conditions are varied, like for example, how that is the, if the barrel temperature is increases, that is the product temperature, water absorption index, expansion and color change, this is likely to increase. Whereas, the torque, die pressure, specific mechanical energy, they are likely to decrease with the increase in the barrel temperature. As far as the feed moisture is concerned, if the feed moisture is high, if it increases, the density will be more, water absorption index will be more, the change in the color, torque, die pressure and specific mechanical energy will be less. The density, water absorption index, torque and die pressure increases with increase in the feed rate, and change in the color and water absorption index decreases with the increase in the feed rate. So, accordingly one should appropriately maintain the barrel temperature, the feed moisture and the feed rate to get the desired system parameter and ultimately desired product characteristics. There are different types of raw materials used in the extrusion process, and they have different functions to play inside the extruder actually in final shaping the product characteristics. For example, there are certain ingredients which are used as a structure forming material, like for example, maize, wheat, rice, potato, oats, etcetera. So, they are used to provide the finally the desired structure of the material, and depending upon the size of the granules present in this, depending upon the type and amount of the starch, the protein and lipid system, etcetera, all these present in that, these materials give the, they give different characteristics to that. For example, maize, here it has medium sized granules, it has average protein level and it has a definite flavor and yellow color. So, it imparts a good flavor and good color in the extruded product, and also because of its arrangements, etcetera, of the components, granular size, etcetera, it expands well. Similarly, wheat flour also, it expands well because of its starch and protein characteristics. Rice flour, it has a small tightly packed starch granules, it slowly hydrates and gets starch gets gelatinized during the processing, it has average protein levels and it gives bland flavor and white color. So, because of these differences or these characteristics material, it provides accordingly desired characteristics into the structure forming action in the extruder product, and also it results into a fully well expanded products. Potato, on the other hand, it has large granules, high starch level, it also has definite flavor, it is gold to light brown color, and the starch characteristics of the potato also results in well or good expansion, but the material becomes sticky. So, you can say that it is a excellent binder. This can be used for binding purposes. Oats, they contain large fiber and highest content of lysine as compared to other cereals, etcetera. The other type of material, they can be used as a fillers. That is, the fillers are most frequently protein fractions of oil seeds and the cereal grains, which are added to the main ingredient that we discussed in the last slide. And these fillers, in fact, they improve the flexibility of the dough after hydration during mass plasticization inside the extruder. They reduce the swelling of starch during the mass forcing through the die, and also they reduce the size of air bubbles during the expansion of the extrudate, thereby influencing the shape of the final products. So, these are the functions of the different fillers. The plasticizers, they are in an extrusion cooked mixture, normally water, oil, fats and emulsifiers, they are used, that they serve as the functions of plasticizers. They influence the flow of the material inside the extruder, they reduce the degradation of the starch, and they positively affect the quality and nutritional value of the product. The other type of the material ingredients can be used hydrocolloids, like they are used for providing thickening effect, stabilization and gelling effects for the improvement of the physical characteristics and textural properties of the end product. These hydrocolloids, they modify texture of the starch based food products, as well as they influence the melting characteristics, gelatinization, fragmentation and retrogradation processes. Hydrocolloids improve the thermostability and provide lubrication during the extrusion process. The emulsifiers are also frequently used. In fact, the emulsifiers are the lipid fractions with higher melting temperature. They are used by the manufacturer in the extruded product as lubricants. They facilitate shear and formation of uniform surface structure. They protect processed mass against stickiness and thus making further treatment easier. The most commonly used emulsifiers in the products are in the extrusion technology are the soya lecithin and mono and diglyceride esters. Apart from this, sometime depending upon the requirement of the product, some raising agents can also be used, such as to provide aeration of the mass and help to obtain the typical crispy and porous structure of the extrudates. For example, the baking powder, etcetera, sometime they can be used. And finally, and you can say last but not the least important, are the taste components. In fact, the material added to improve the taste, like salt, sugar, sometimes some spices, etcetera, are added to provide desired taste into the extruded product. And let us see effect of extrusion processing parameters, extrusion processing conditions on the material characteristics. To start with the starch, we will see, because starch is one major component in the structure forming action, which influences the product texture and other characteristics. So, during the extrusion processing, the starch granules in presence of water undergo the process of gelatinization. And if the extrusion conditions are severe, which you can see here in this, there is the raw rice granules, how the starch looks like, then starch gelatinizes with the water and heat which is there inside the screw barrel, etcetera. And depending upon the conditions of temperature and pressure present inside the barrel, this starch granules gets damaged by the shear forces, etcetera, and finally, it can be broken down, it can be dry hydrolysis may take place, it may get converted into dextrinization. And in fact, this dextrinized starch sometimes gives the sweeter taste, because these dextrins are intermediate between glucose and the starch molecule. They have the intermediate characteristics, that is less sweeter than glucose, but better sweeter, more sweeter than the starch. Okay. So, these high shear conditions are necessary in fact to maximize the conversion of starch into glucose, so that the material becomes, it gets the better sensory characteristics and other components. Even sometimes this glucose etcetera, they also in some products, that is, they contribute to the browning of the brown color development and the extruded product, which also is a, in those products are in some products is a desirable. So, the loss of crystallinity can also be observed in the extruded product, and this is basically because of the, that is the gelatinization effect. Okay, the gelatinized starch, cellular protein and the cellulosic material etcetera, which might be there in the raw material, they are one complex which decisively influence the product expansion ability after forcing them through the dye. Okay. So, these, that is the gelatinized starch, the protein, that is in which form it is denatured or in the native, and to the what the extent it has been denatured, to the what extent it has been gelatinized, the starch has been gelatinized, protein has been denatured, and the other cellulosic material etcetera. So, all this will actually influence to a great extent the expandability and other characteristics in the final product. So, the starch in fact is very, very important ingredient as far as the extruded products and their characteristics are concerned. They are used for density control, they are used to provide strength in the material. Actually, certain modified starches can increase the strength and reduce breakage in the expanded products. They might result in the shelf life improvement, moisture uptake, they improve the flavor of the materials, even water holding capacity, fat binding capacity, all these properties, functionality and other things of the material is provided and adequately by having a proper amount and quantity and type of the starch by controlling the conditions to control the starch gelatinization, retrogradation etcetera, we can get desired characteristics. Okay. So, another important component, most of this grains etcetera which are used for extrusion, the structure forming action, they also along with the starch, they have the protein. So, the extrusion process conditions, they also have the important influence on the protein characteristics, and this in turn influences the product characteristics. Like for example, native proteins are denatured during extrusion process. The forces in fact in the native protein, that is the tertiary structure, secondary structure, quaternary structure, they are held up, held in its native form by appropriate interactions, interactive bonded, maybe covalent linkages, sulfide linkage and all those things. So, all these forces in fact which are responsible to keep the structure in its native form, they are weakened by a combination of increased temperature and shear within the extruder barrel. So, the individual protein molecule unfold and align themselves with the flow of the material towards the dye. The exposure of hydrophobic residues such as phenyl alanine and tyrosine, they reduce the solubility of the extruded protein in aqueous systems. So, here you can see in this figure, that is, this is the native protein, that is, they get that is opened and the flow is there, native structure is disturbed, all right. And even what will happen, that is, the, if there is a this hydrophobic R group, if they are extended, which are normally that is the, how they are extended towards the native structure. If they are all on the surface, then protein has good solubility. And these hydrolytic R group, if they are maybe as a result of this denaturation, they may go towards the interior of the molecule and they may get disturbed. So, the protein solubility may get disturbed. Accordingly, the extruded product may be less soluble than compared to the, because of these changes in the protein characteristics. As far as the effect of lipids on extrusion processing is concerned, that is, extrusion of high fat materials is generally not advisable, especially in the case of expanded product. If you want that is, the material should expand after extrusion, the fat content should be kept low as possible. For example, if the lipid level is more than 5 to 6%, it impairs extruder performance, and the presence of lipid in the raw material causes decrease in the torque because the lipid reduces slip within the barrel. Okay. There is poor expansion of the product because insufficient pressure is developed. Lipid is released from the cells owing to the high temperature and physical disruption of the plant cell walls. So, this also increases fat content, it may have some difficulties or it may influence the product characteristics. Low lipid level, less than 5% in the material, facilitate steady extrusion and improve the texture. The extrusion processes can prevent free fatty acid release by denaturing the hydrolytic enzyme. So, that is, the material can become, that is, the hydrolytic rancidity, etcetera, in the material, that is, in the extruded product, can be prevented or can be less in compared to the normal products, because the heat generated inside the pressure inside the extruder barrel can cause the hydrolytic enzymes. So, therefore, the hydrolytic rancidity can be prevented. The effect of extrusion processing on vitamins, in fact, the retention of vitamins in extrusion cooking decreases with increasing temperature, screw speed and specific energy output. It also decreases with decreasing moisture, feed rate and dry diameter. That is, if the dry diameter is decreases, then in this the vitamins retention will decrease. Okay. Then, depending on the vitamin concerned, considerable degradation can occur, especially in the product with high sensory appeal. So, the temperature and pressure in the barrel, they may result into the destruction of the vitamins. So, the care should be taken to have minimum change or minimum destruction of the vitamins. Okay. So, what can be done? That is, the uses of a specific vitamin compounds or forms of application with improved stability. That is, those vitamins which have better stability, they should be used, they can be used, and sometime addition of extra amounts of vitamins, maybe vitamin mineral premix can be used, which can be added into the product to make up the losses, and this addition can be done during extrusion or storage stage, or even it can be applied post extrusion, either by dusting, enrobing, spraying, coating or filling together with other ingredients that can be applied. So, by this one can, we can maintain desired quantity of vitamins. Similarly, the extrusion process, its effects are minerals, we can say. Generally, minerals are more heat stable and therefore, they are not likely to become lost in the steam distillate at the dye. However, extrusion can improve the absorption of minerals by reducing other factors that inhibit absorption. Mineral absorption could be affected by the phytate, polyphenols like tannins, etc., and fiber components. So, cellulose, lignin, and some hemicellulose affect the mobility of these minerals in the gastrointestinal tract and interfere with the absorption, their absorption process. So, while tannins might be insoluble complexes, might form insoluble complexes with divalent ions in the gastrointestinal tract. So, the extrusion hydrolyzes the phytates, decomposes the polyphenols, reorganizes the fiber components, and changes chelating properties, and this explains the higher availability of the mineral after extrusion processing, that is the particularly after high temperature extrusion. So, the availability of the mineral in our system, it might be more in the extruded product. Extrusion process improves the availability absorption characteristics of the minerals. Another very important thing, that is acrylamide formation. That is, acrylamides, normally it is a group 2A carcinogen, and it is found common in foods which are prepared or which are exposed to a temperature of more than 120 degrees Celsius or so. For example, in the potato chips, expanded RT, snacks, etc. And here the causative agents are mainly amino acid, which contribute to the acrylamide formation is aspargine, and especially in the presence of reducing sugars like glucose, etc. This aspargine reacts with the glucose and the sugar amine acrylamide is formed. So, during extrusion, the feed and product moisture content, process temperature, and resultant energy inputs are relevant parameters for the acrylamide formation, and accordingly they can be properly controlled. For example, if the temperature during inside the extrusion barrel, etc., is maintained less than 120 degrees Celsius, the formation of extrusion can be either eliminated or can be avoided. Also, the presence of glycine, cysteine, and lysine has the significant effects on the decrease in acrylamide content in the fried products. Now, in next few slides, I will just like to give you a glimpse of overview of the, that is, we at our institute in my laboratory, food chemistry and technology laboratory, my students, they have worked on several process innovations, particularly extrusion process innovations, and developed different products which you can see here in this slide, like fortified rice kernels, okay, energy essential amino acid balance Nutridal, that is expanded ready to eat snacks, maybe from the millets, etc., sweet potato extrudates, chlorella fortified pasta, fortified rice noodles, and so on, fortified rice kernel. So, some of these products have been developed in a laboratory using one or the other materials, and most of these, they are all considered good healthy products, because the process parameters are selected in such a way. That is, for example, these expanded snacks products, this is here by appropriate selection of the process parameters, that is, it's ready to eat form. When it comes out of extruder, it becomes in ready to eat form. So, no frying and other things might be required here. So, maybe some of these products and their manufacturing technologies, we will be taking, there is details we will be taking in some lecture classes separately, but today just I will try to give you an overview in the glimpse, like for example, fortified rice kernels, where these are made by using the broken rice, that is, the broken rice from the rice mill is taken, it is converted into that flour, milled into flour, all right, and where the fortificants are added, and these conditioned rice flour added with the fortificant like iron, folic acid, and vitamin B12 in the appropriate quantity, that is as per the guidelines set by Food Standards, Food Safety and Standards Authority of India. This is forced through a extruder, and that is extruder also is designed and developed indigenously for this purpose, and the rice die has been designed is forced through the die, and you can see here that is we get that is these are the fortified rice kernels that is which are made using this extrusion technology. Of course, here inside that extruder barrel just at the die head we manipulate the condition of temperature pressure in such a way that when material comes out there is a sufficient degree of compression in the products, the compaction in the product region expands, and this these rice they have the desired characteristics, they are resemble to normal rice in their cooking, eating and other sensory characteristics. And you can see here in this picture that after cooking it retains its shape, it does not disintegrates. Similarly, another product is that is the essential amino acid balance nutri dal. So, that is a dal actually, it is the split, pulses split, and it is cooked and eaten, cooked with some salt, spices, etcetera, and eaten. And these cooked dals, in fact, they form a major source or that is the important source for the protein in the people who are vegetarian, who totally depend on the vegetarian. So, and you know that the none of the pulses which is produced normally, there is a leguminous crops, they have all essential amino acid the same. So, what we have done here in this case, that is we have taken the broken of different dal mills or pulse milling industries, and these broken using linear programming, that is they are appropriately mixed, and this ground and the ground here also we have a designed die giving the shape. So, this is forced through the extruder in the desired pressure and temperature conditions, and we get the dal shape. And after cooking you can see here how, so these dals, extruded dal, and since this we are calling it nutri dal because this contains in the single product is contains essential amino acid, all essential amino acids are contained in this, and not only the number type of, but also their quantity, that it is comparable, 100 gram of this dal is comparable to 100 grams of egg as far as the amino acid composition, essential amino acid composition is concerned. The other product is the gluten free pasta. Here also we have taken some pulse flour, that is the chickpea flour and rice flour, and they are mixed together, a batter is formed, mixed and conditioned, and after this mixing conditioning they are fed to the extruder, all right, and finally it is dried and we get gluten free pasta. So, since here no heat is a, so the ingredient itself we have taken, that is a gluten free, but of course the extrusion process conditions etcetera are particularly mixing and conditioning is designed in such a way or optimized in such a way that we get the desired characteristics of the pasta, that is it retains its shape, it doubles swell double when it is cooked. So, desired characteristics of the pasta are there in this product. The other product is accordingly fortified rice noodle. We have the same type of machine, that is which have fortified rice, fortified rice kernel, fortified dal, nutri dal, similarly fortified rice noodle. We are taking rice flour, we are adding appropriate or desired quantity of the micronutrient, iron, folic acid, vitamin B12, and then mixing and conditioning. After mixing and conditioning, they are fed to the extruder, all right, where the appropriate die is provided or given to give the desired shape of the noodle. And this noodle also, it resembles the commercial products in its sensory and other characteristics. So, it is a health noodle as it has been fortified by micronutrients, iron, vitamin B12 and folic acid. So, the other product is the preparation of sweet potato flour. The sweet potato flour preparation using extrusion technology, that is here the sweet potato is taken, it is soaked, there is a washed and put into the sliced and then soaked, and after soaking it is dried, conditioned and then fed into the extruder. And here in the extrusion actually it results in the significant reduction of the trypsin inhibitor and also improvement in the in vitro digestibility takes place, in vitro digestibility improvement takes place, and finally we get sweet potato extruders. And these sweet potato extruders are further ground into flour. This sweet potato extruded flour, that is, which has improved digestibility, low complete inhibition of the trypsin inhibitor activity and other anti nutrients. So, this is a very good ingredient for use in the food products and other. So, in fact, we have used this extruded this sweet potato flour in the preparation of high energy ready to eat food for malnourished children. The other product you can say that protein and fiber rich ready to eat snack foods, like there is the there is the pea protein which we have taken for the expansion. There is the pea protein added with corn flour in appropriate amount and some apple pomace. So, here it is a protein rich material, comparatively less starch, and this apple fiber rich. So, these are mixed in the appropriate amount and then finally fed to the extruder under desired conditions in the extruder barrel, and finally they are material is obtained that is the of desired characteristics, the ready to eat expanded snacks. So, in fact, the details of some of this, particularly this fortified rice kernel, nutri dal, fortified noodles, etcetera, we will take up separately in little detail. So, with I hope you have got a good understanding by now about the extrusion technology, different materials which are used for the extrusion or which form a good raw material for the extrusion process, the extrusion system parameters, extrusion process parameters, material characteristics, how they are proper combinations by proper adjustment of these things one can get do and to get in order to get the desired product characteristics. With this, I Sangeet, thank you for your kind attention.